And they entered in and dwelt there, and the last state of the man is worse than the first, even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. Matthew chapter 12, verse 46. While he was still talking to the multitudes, everybody say, while he was still talking. This morning, what I'm going to share with you is this message entitled Worn Out Tires. This morning, what we are going to focus, as you see the key word there, we're going to talk about focus. We're going to talk about distractions, okay? Because distractions is something that we are inundated with right now. Everywhere in the world, we are distracted with so much stuff. Wouldn't you agree? No matter where you go, no matter what you do, you are distracted by a million and one things that are going on out in the world. And we're going to talk about some of those things. So Jesus here is speaking to the multitudes, and behold, his mother and brother stood outside seeking to speak with him. Then one said to him, look, your mother and your brothers are standing outside seeking to speak with you. Now let me interject something here. What Jesus is actually addressing here in the 12th chapter is the Pharisees had come to him and talked to him about and was questioning him about seeking signs, about following signs and wanting signs. And we know that Jesus often said, it's a perverse generation that seeketh signs. The end in that 45th verse, they actually are talking about demon possession. And how somebody that can be delivered, but because they don't remain in that condition, if they open themselves back up to that possession again, they become seven times worse. How many would think if you're in that conversation, that's a pretty heavy conversation to be in? Amen? And so if we're in that conversation, if Nate was sitting and talking to John and they were having a conversation about that context and that content right there, then to have Jeremiah come up and interrupt Nate and say, hey, mom and dad's outside and they want to talk to you. Jeremiah would be completely oblivious to the weight of the conversation that has taken place between Nate and John. Wouldn't you agree with that? Okay, Terry agrees. Anybody else agree in the building? Okay, that's a real heavy, serious conversation for them to be in. Amen? And because Jeremiah perhaps wasn't paying attention to what was being said, or perhaps he was outside, he just came in and interrupted. Well, this is what was taking place with Jesus. Jesus is in a very serious conversation, a very needful conversation, and one of his disciples comes to him and said, hey, your mother and your brothers are standing outside and they want to talk to you. Not paying attention to the weight of the issue. But he answered and said to the one who told him, who is my brother and who are my brothers? And he stretched out his hand towards the disciples and said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whosoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. I believe that was a rebuke. Now you may read it differently, but when I read that, I see that Jesus, in a very kind way, rebuked his disciple because he did not understand the seriousness of the conversation that was taking place. Here Jesus is ministering on a serious matter, and here comes the distraction. Anything to throw him off his focal point, but Jesus wasn't having it. He stayed focused on the task at hand. This is where we often fail. Amen? Jesus goes on in this chapter to describe to us the focal point of these parables. It is the condition of a person's heart as it pertains to bearing fruit. The entire 13th chapter is dealing with the condition of a human's heart, condition of a person's heart as it pertains to bearing fruit. Everyone say bearing fruit. His first parable is, of course, the parable of the sower. But I'm going to come back to that here in just a minute. We're going to talk very specifically about the parable of the sower. The second parable is the parable of the man sowing the seed in his own field. During the night, the time of sleep and slumber, both the wheat and the tares grow up together. The parable clearly describes how even in our hearts there can be good seed and weeds growing at the same time. How many would agree? Listen, I can preach to you the word of God, the seed of God's word, and it can become part of you and it can begin to mature and start to grow inside of you. At the same time, It's warring against traditions. It's warring against theologies. It's warring against other things that has infiltrated our mind. And so at the very same time, we can have the seed of God's word that is trying to grow inside of our heart, and yet it is being choked out by other stuff. Would you agree? Now there's a huge difference between sowing seed and planting seed. When a person sows seed, do you see the picture up here? What is he doing right there? He's just scattering seed, isn't he? He's not concerned about where it falls. He's prepared the field as best he could, but when he is sowing the seed, he's doing it in a mass quantity. Amen? There's a difference between sowing and planting. Planting seed, it's a deliberate, specific act of placing the seed where you want it to go. Okay? I asked a question last Sunday morning, what was Jesus? Was he a planter or a sower? And we concluded that he was both. Because there was times that he preached to the multitudes. Amen? He was speaking to the multitudes right there in the 12th chapter. But then there were times that he pulled the disciples aside, just like he does at the end of the 13th chapter, and he begins to describe to them, and he begins to interpret the parables to them. So there was a time where he specifically pulled them aside and began to plant seed inside of their hearts. Everybody see the difference? We need both. Amen? We need to be able to do both. Jesus clearly says, go into all the world and preach the gospel. That's sowing the seed. But he also said to make disciples. That's planting the seed. Everybody say planting the seed. So as we read here, we find out in that parable, the second parable, that in the field that is being sown, there are weeds and there is the good seed that is growing up together. If we place it in context of our lesson this morning, we can have the Word of God planted in our hearts, and though we have God's Word hidden in our hearts that we might not sin, distractions or tares or weeds are growing there as well, trying to choke out the life from this seed. The third parable is the parable of the mustard seed. How it appears to be the least, yet grows to be the greatest in our lives. This too is how our hearts can flourish with the smallest of God's word in our hearts, if it's been properly and deliberately planted. Do you see the difference? When the seed of God's word has been deliberately and specifically planted in your heart, it can seem so insignificant to everybody else, but that one small minute detail can be the most powerful, life-changing detail in your personal life. Amen? It may not mean anything to Dylan, but it means something to Gail. Are you catching what I'm saying here? Okay? That's the third parable, the parable of the mustard seed. The fourth parable is the parable of the leaven, where the smallest of distractions can affect our entire focus. The smallest of distractions can affect our entire focus. How many agrees with that? Consider a person driving in a car, and they get a phone call on their cell phone. They don't have hands-free, and they look down just for a moment to pick up their phone to see who has called them, and the traffic stops up in front of them. Just the smallest of distraction can infect everything that is around you. Are you following me this morning? Okay, so this morning, we are going to talk about these distractions. Nothing is of so much importance that we should allow it to distract us from the mission that we share with the lost world. There's value in the mission that we are sharing. Wouldn't you agree with that? So let's turn, we're going to go back into the 13th chapter, and we're going to begin reading and we're going to look between verses 18 and 23. We're going to actually doesn't go right back to that same scripture or that same thing here. This morning we're going to talk about focus. Everyone say focus. Focus. I thought this was a perfect description, an acronym of what focus. Follow one course until successful. Follow one course until successful. How many ways are there to heaven? Only one. Everybody say one. There's only one way, regardless of what Oprah Winfrey or anybody else says. There's only one way to heaven, and that is through Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man gets to the Father except through me, right? He talks about being the door and the shepherd. He gives descriptions that he is the key. Everybody say, Jesus is the key.
Jesus.
Follow one course until successful. Folks, I want you to understand, true success will not be determined until you hear Jesus say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of the Lord. Verse 19, we find the hearer unable to keep his attention on the things just presented to him. Let's take a look at this verse. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and doesn't understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away that which has been sown in his heart. I want you to pay attention to these words here this morning, okay? Snatches away that which has been sown. That means seed has reached its destination. All right? It's sown in his heart. This is what was sown by the roadside. In this particular verse, we see the distraction when it comes. Have you ever been sitting in a service? I was actually talking about Gail about this yesterday. Have you ever been sitting in a service and the preacher is preaching and suddenly a particular thought or scripture touches your heart and you begin to search for a pen and a pencil and a piece of paper so you can write that scripture down? Anybody ever done that? And by the time you find your pen, by the time you find the paper, for some of you, like Jim yesterday when he was wanting to look at some things and he said, I forgot my glasses. Some of you have to find your glasses. Right? Terry will look all over the house looking for her glasses, only to find out that they're sitting on top of her head. Right? And by the time you find all of that stuff and you get ready to write it down, you forgot what the scripture was. Or you forgot what the thought was. You know why? It's because our minds are being inundated with distractions. Everyone say distractions. Our minds are being inundated with distractions. Let me tell you, as you get older, this becomes more realistic every day. Our minds are inundated with stuff. Work stuff, home stuff, church stuff, family stuff, etc. And just like a preacher once said to another pastor friend of mine, we were sitting in a restaurant, and he said, hey, Bob, I heard you had a thought one time, but it got lonely and left. Anyone can relate? Amen. You ever had that happen? I had a thought one time. It just got lonely and left. Amen. Sometimes that happens to us. And the reason is because we are so consumed with the distractions and the thoughts and all of the things that go on in our life. In a life that is filled with distractions, we too experience this life of fleeing thoughts. This is how the enemy robs you of opportunities. Consider it. All during the week, opportunities have presented themselves to you. Opportunities to pray with somebody, to bless somebody that was in need. But before you could determine whether this was God or you, right? Before you can make that determination, and while you're arguing with your inner self, somebody else either blessed them or they wandered off out of your sight and you missed the opportunity. That ever happened to you? The Lord says something to your heart and says that you need to minister to this person, whether you're praying for them, whether you're just speaking to them, whether you're greeting them, whatever the case may be. And so in your mind, you're thinking, well, I don't want to invade their personal space. I don't want to be a burden to them. I don't want to do this and I don't want to do that. And you start debating all of this stuff in your mind until eventually the person walks away. And then oftentimes you'll go, well, that must not have been the Lord. Huh? Truth is, the enemy has distracted you, and he's kept you distracted just long enough that the opportunity was missed. I think this happens to us far more than what we are willing to or able to even admit to. And this is something that we have to war against. This is the seed that has fallen by the wayside, taken from you before it could take root in your heart. And here's the sad part about that. When those opportunities present themselves And because you are debating within yourself, and because you get distracted with all of these thoughts, and you get distracted with this, that, and the other, the problem is you will never see what that seed could have become. Oftentimes, we'll just write it off as a missed opportunity. But what happens if that opportunity could have changed not only that person's life, but the entire family's? We read in the scripture all the time how Jesus, or whether it was Paul or one of the other disciples, ministered to an individual and their whole household was saved. Amen? So we don't know what the catalyst is that will change a person's life. Not just their life, but everybody that is around them. We talk about having revival, but folks, revival has got to start inside of us before it ever starts somewhere else. If revival don't take place in your heart, you know what revival is? Revival is, in its simplicity, is getting back to a place that you once was. That's what revival is. And if we don't think we need revival, that shows how much we need revival. We need revival. We need God to stir within our hearts again the mindset that there is a lost world out there that will go to a devil's hell if we don't reach them with the message of hope. I had a pastor talk to me just a couple days ago, and he asked me, he said, Shane, let me ask you a question. How do we reach this world? How are we going to reach this world? And I said, well, I'll be honest with you. I think we complicate things far more than what they should be. Jesus made the gospel very simplistic, didn't he? If we'd love the Lord with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind, give him everything we have, and then love our neighbor as ourselves, he said, you can take all the other teachings, everything else, and you can hang it right there on those two teachings. If we would concentrate on those two things, loving God with all of our heart and loving people, it could change our world. It's true. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. If we would pay attention to that and just extend the name of Christ in every direction that we go, if we would simply lift him up, that could make a change in people's lives. He said he would draw all men unto me. Listen, we get in trouble when we start trying to figure out how to grow the church. It's not our job to grow the church. It's our job to sow the seed and to plant the seed. And he will give the increase. Let's go on to verse 20. Verse 20 says, what was sown on the rocky places, this is he who hears the word. Everybody say, hears the word. And immediately receives with joy. Receives it. He's happy to receive the word. Are you happy to hear the word this morning? Are you happy to receive the word this morning? Well, let me tell you what can potentially happen in verse 21. It goes on to say, yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. When oppression or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. When we consider what the scripture is telling us, if you can make it out of the service this morning, remembering what I've preached to you today, that's going to be an accomplishment. Because the truth is, most times we forget by the time of mid-afternoon after we've had our nap. After we've eaten and had our nap and we have been inundated with so many other distractions, we forgot what even the preacher was preaching about in the morning. It's true. Why? Because we're a culture of distraction. We are a culture of distraction. If you can remember where you put your notes from the sermon, if you can find the time to push life aside for just a little while, the word will begin to germinate and grow inside of your heart. But understand, just because it's growing inside of you doesn't mean that it's completely protected or even matured. Remember when I preached here a couple weeks ago about the acorn to the oak tree? And I talked about how it takes 4 years before that acorn can reproduce itself, or that tree can reproduce itself. That acorn is not going to, it's not going to grow into the ground, become a sapling, and suddenly start reproducing acorns. It takes time for it to mature to a point that it can reproduce. I think that's the same thing in the church. I think that there's a time and a place for us, that there's a time that we have to grow and we have to mature and allow the Word of God to reproduce itself inside of us before we can ever reproduce ourselves out into the world. But But make no mistake, this is our responsibility. We are to bear fruit, amen? More fruit and much fruit. Some of you will only lead one person to the Lord in your entire life, but every one of us should at least say that sinner's prayer with one person in this life. We are instructed to bear fruit. Bearing fruit, and contrary to the big argument that sometimes gets on in the theological world, bearing fruit is not just necessarily the fruit of the Spirit. Oh, we just have to be joyful. That's the fruit he's talking about. No, he's talking about reproduction. He's talking about winning a lost person to the Lord. Sharing your testimony, discipling, and what did I say? Specifically and deliberately planting the Word of God inside of another person's heart. And then you're going to tend to that seed, and you're going to watch that seed, and as that seed begins to grow, you're going to protect that seed, amen? You're going to guard that seed, because if we don't, the enemy is quick to be there to rob us of that seed. Even in this state, the word can be robbed or taken from you because of distractions. Someone hurts your feelings, and once again, it's taken from you. It stretches your belief system, and it's ripped from your heart before it can reach maturity. You see, true transformation comes not in the seed planting. Listen very closely. True transformation does not come in seed planting, not in adolescence or the seedling stage. It only comes when the seed that was strategically and deliberately planted in your heart reaches its full potential. Did you catch that? Let's consider the tree again. If it takes an oak tree 4 years to become mature enough from the acorn stage until the place of maturity that it can reproduce itself, true transformation does not take place until it has reached the point of reproduction. How do I say that? Because everything prior to that is transition. Everyone say transition. Transition. There's a difference between transition and transformation. Amen. Transition is the process or the journey getting there. Amen. Transformation is something that happens on the inside that creates in us completely different circumstances that enables us to reproduce. Think about it. When you came to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, old things have to pass away, everything becomes new. But sometimes, even in that process, once that person comes to the knowledge of Jesus Christ and they surrender their heart, then, Ray, there's still a transition time. Because what we're asking them to do is leave everything they know. Amen. It's not just us asking that, but the Bible says that we have to forsake those things that can be detrimental to our spiritual good being and good health. Amen. We have to let those things go. We have to sift them from our lives. If we don't sift them from our lives, then they can infect us, and they become those weeds and those tares that are growing up that are trying to choke out the Word of God. Are you following me this morning? Touch your neighbor and say, that's a good word. Well, we're just not too enthusiastic here today. Here in this verse, we are challenged about the depth of our relationship. There's more to serving the Lord than just knowing who He is. Wouldn't you agree with that? No root doesn't mean that the word was bad or ineffective, but it means distractions have hindered us from digging into that relationship with fervor and perseverance. I see it in the lives of parents all the time. Distractions come into the household, and instead of pushing away those distractions and remaining faithful, they succumb to those distractions and they skip out, missing what God really wants to pour into their life. And they're adults and they have the right to do that. We all have that right. But here's the problem. That's the example that we are teaching our children, those who are watching us, those who are mimicking us, those who are following after us. When I was coaching fast pitch many years ago, I seen this happen all the time. People invested into their children. They invested into their children. Jim, sometimes thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars they would invest into the best coaches, and especially pitchers, the best pitching coaches or the best hitting coaches. And they would spend thousands of dollars above and beyond what they spent on the team and for that child to play in the team. Because in their mind, Mary, they believed that that child had the ability to become something very special. Now, every parent should feel that way about their kids. The problem that I've seen is they would invest those things when it comes to sports. They would invest into those kids' lives, but morality, man, living the right life, sharing Jesus with them, that was something that they just did an hour once a week at best. We will go to all of our kids' games and we'll invest thousands of dollars, and there is no distance too great because we want to invest in our kids. But oftentimes, we don't pour the Word of God into those children. We don't teach them the way that they ought to live. And then when they get grown up and they start making bad choices, we start to panic as parents. Then we want a do-over. Then we start going back trying to reteach them all over again. But here's the problem. They've grown up. And we say, I don't understand how you can do the things that you're doing. I don't understand the direction. Where did you go wrong? When really, all they're doing is following the example that you and I set for them. How important is it then to teach your child and train up a child in the way that they should go? Because in this life, folks, we don't get do-overs. Amen. The decisions you make today will affect your tomorrow. Hello? The decisions you make today will affect your tomorrow, should the Lord give us a tomorrow. But understand, the things that have happened in the past are in the past, and there is nothing that is in the past that we should allow to alter our present day. That's when we start getting in trouble, when we start trying to go back and redo. Amen. What the Lord wants us to do is move forward. Everybody say, move forward. The distractions that we're surrounded by, we can be aware of who's doing what on Facebook. This was a tough one for me to write out. This was tough for me to type because I'm just as guilty as everybody. We can be aware of who's doing what on Facebook but not know the names of our neighbors. That's a tough one. I'll have you know though, I met Mike yesterday. He's the new family. He's the dad of the new family that lives across the street over here. And Sister Tilly actually opened up the door. I was talking to her. We were having the rummage sale yesterday, and we were talking to her about the new family that moved over there. And she said, "Are they Islanders?" I thought I said, "Are they Islanders?" I said, "I believe they're Samoan." And next thing I know, I went back into the church to do something. Next thing I know, I look across the street, and Tilly's sitting over there as if she'd known him her whole life. She didn't let that be an obstacle at all. A road, that wasn't no obstacle to Tilly. She literally went over there. And in fact, as we were coming, he was barbecuing, and my mouth was watering so bad I couldn't hardly stand it. And I hollered over to him, and I said, "Man, you're killing me." I said, "That smells so good. My mouth is watering." Well, Tilly goes over, introduces herself. She's sitting over there, and I mean literally, leaned up against the house as if she'd known him her whole life. And she's over there sharing with them and witnessing to them, talking about our church and all of those types of things. And next thing I know, when we went back up, we picked everything up, we went back over to the house, we get a knock on the door, and Sister Tilly had brought over that Mike over here had made me a to-go plate and said, "Give this to the pastor." Boy, those are friends. That's a friend right there. And so as we were getting ready to go to town, I pulled over there and I jumped out and I went over and I introduced myself to Mike and told him how much I appreciated him giving us the food and welcome to the neighborhood. And he said, "What time are your church services?" So I shared with him. And he was raised in a different denomination. He was raised in, with a different upbringing. But you know what I have found out? That if we will just take the step and not allow distractions to steer us away from the important things, and the important things are developing a relationship, Tom, that if we can get over there and develop a relationship with Mike and his family, we don't know what the Lord is going to do in their life. You hear me? But if we allow the distractions, because I had things to do, and because we had to go to town, and we had this, and we had that. We were doing a rummage sale. But you know what? Tilly didn't allow the rummage sale to become a distraction to her. Where's Tilly today? Tilly is working today. Does she attend our church on an every Sunday basis? Absolutely not. But she went over there and bragged on our church. Told them, you need to go over there and see what's going on at that church. It's an awesome place. She didn't allow anything to become a distraction to get her focus off of ministering to somebody about Jesus. We can know what the Supreme Court ruling was and become so disgusted and distracted by it that we sit around talking about the travesty of our government allowing such a thing and lose focus on the bigger issue. What's the bigger issue? The issue isn't, folks, the issue isn't same-sex marriage or anything of the kind. The issue is a sinful world is making sinful decisions. Big shock. Spoiler alert, right? A sinful world makes sinful decisions. But what are we supposed to do about that? Love people. Love God, love people. We don't have to like the things that are going on, but we certainly need to share Christ with people. That's our focus. Everyone say, that's my focus. Remember the disciples when they were with Jesus at the well in Samaria? Jesus told them that he needed to go away or to go that way. Why? Because there was a soul that needed saving. But the disciples were more focused and distracted by Jesus eating something than the very woman Jesus would minister to. The very woman that would lead the first evangelistic charge to the Gentiles. The same woman that passed those same disciples, not once, but twice. But they were so concerned about what Jesus was going to eat. How many this morning are concerned about what your pastor is going to eat today? By line. Tom, she's just going to try and keep the good stuff away from me. I know how this is going to go. This morning, I dare say that your minds right now are inundated with stuff. And you're getting some of what I'm saying, bits and pieces of what I'm saying. But if you're not careful, you'll miss the meat of what God is trying to speak into our life, because we can't take into captivity the thoughts that are trying to rise up against the knowledge of God. Why? Because we're a culture of distraction. We don't have to search for people because we see them every day in every store, in every restaurant, on every street corner, and on every job. Lift up your eyes, for the fields are wide and ready to harvest, Jesus said. Hate the sin, love the lost. Love the lost. Amen? Remember, each one, reach one, each one, teach one. That means investing in your relationship with God first, and then into the lives of people. But if your root is shallow, and the reason it's shallow is because we don't have time to pray, we don't have time to study, oftentimes we don't have time to make it even to church to even hear the Word of God preached. And we use excuses like, well, I'll watch it on TV, or I'll listen to it on the radio, or I'll buy the CD. But we're missing the opportunity to be in the presence of the Lord, where God can change our lives. Why? Because of distractions. Distractions, distractions, distractions. I shared in the earlier part of the message that the devil has devised a plan and wrapped it in the most awesome packages to rob you of your seed. Those distractions can be your children. They can be your children. Last night when we were having practice in here, worship team practice, John's little one, he was just bound and determined. He had taken care of himself long enough. Long about 8:30, he started making it abundantly clear, okay, I'm done with practice, Dad. You know, it's time to do something different. And so he became very restless, and he had done everything. He had run out of stuff to do. And so John is trying to practice, and he told me, he said, Pastor, even this morning, he said, Pastor, it don't matter what we practice, he said, because I was so distracted last night, I was having a hard time focusing on what we were doing. He didn't even know what I was preaching this morning. It wasn't that his little boy was doing anything bad, he's just a little boy. But even our children can become a distraction. Have you ever tried to set a time, prayer time, or study time? Sister Stephanie, in your household, I imagine that is a challenge. Because there's so much that is going on. I'm not even going to make reference to Sister Mary, because there's so much going on over there in her house with construction and doing everything, and people sick. Her daughter has had some medical issues with her equilibrium and different things like that, and all of these things, and there's children there, and she's trying to study for the lesson, and she calls me and she says, Pastor, I cannot get the idea of distractions out of my mind because my mind is filled with them. Right? We all go through this, don't we? Come on, admit it. We know we all go through this. Distractions, distractions, distractions. But we have enough focus to pick up our cell phones. We have enough focus to get on Facebook. Huh? We have enough focus to play Candy Crush. Terry. See, Terry and Sierra look at each other and they almost hit their faces together. They turn so hard. The devil wraps us in a great package. It's a plan, folks. Everybody say it's his plan. You know, his plan is not just to bring demon-possessed people into the building to threaten our lives and all of that. It's not all that. If he can just keep you distracted, that's an easy one. It don't even take Lucifer himself. He'll just send a little imp in here to cause you to be distracted. A little imp to follow you around in your day-to-day life that keeps you distracted just enough that before Monday, before Sunday is over, you're already thinking about Monday. I remember those days when I was having to, you know, I had projects that I was doing, and I had to think about what was going to happen on Monday. Here was the problem. I was getting off of work on Friday, hello, and I'm thinking about what I had to pick back up on Monday. It doesn't make for a joyful weekend, right? This is how the enemy keeps us distracted. He wraps the package up, and on that little package could be your children. It could be your job. Hello? It could be your job. The job that God has given you and God has blessed you with. And yet that job that God has blessed you with can become the very thing that pulls your relationship in the wrong direction. I tell you, I've watched it happen over and over and over. People come to the church unemployed. We pray that God will give them a job. God blesses them with a great job. And then the job becomes the distraction that keeps them away from the Lord. You follow me? I'm telling you, this is a plan that the devil uses to keep you distracted and keeps you in a weak state. It keeps your root shallow. You know that even your religious beliefs, do you know that your ministry can become a distraction? I know preachers that are so busy, they chase their tails. Ray, they chase their tails all week long. You call them on a phone and they're too busy to even answer the phone. Go straight to voicemail. And I told Terry, it drives me crazy. Nobody's that busy. And if you are that busy, there's a problem. Hello? I want you to be confident that if you call me, I answer my phone. And if I don't, on the rare occasion that I don't answer the phone, I immediately call you back. Sister Mary, ain't that the truth? Because every once in a while, she'll call me and either I'm in the car or something is happening that I can't, or I'm on the phone already. And so I recognize her number and I immediately call her back. It's not because there's a huge emergency. But there's something that she's wanting to impart to me or share with me about the lesson. And we talk about those things all the time because this is how iron sharpens iron. Are you following me? Instead of allowing somebody to pour something into your life and then you pour something into their life, we get so distracted that we don't even share what God is doing in our hearts. We don't share when something exciting that the Lord speaks into us and He shows us through the Word. Oftentimes we become so distracted. We need to call you, Jim. I meant to call you and tell you about this exciting thing that the Lord showed me, but then I got distracted and forgot I was going to call you. Huh? If we're that busy, we're too busy. And that's right where the devil wants us to be. That means investing in your relationship with the Lord first and then into the lives of other people. Let's move on to Matthew chapter 13, verse 22. I think that's hypnotizing. So you can ask me that. I know you guys didn't catch it, y'all. It's all right. Matthew chapter 13, verse 22. And that which was dropped among the thorns, this is he who has the word. Everybody say, has the word. That means he's not just hearing it. He actually possesses it. Amen? Amen, Pastor. And the cares of this life and the deceits of wealth put a stop to the growth of the word, and it gives no fruit. That's the basic Bible English version, but I want you to pay attention to this other version. This is your, I almost said Martin Luther King version. It's not Martin Luther King. This is your modern King James version here, the second one. And it says this, and that sown into the thorns is this, he who hears the word and the anxiety of the world. Anybody ever experience anxiety here in this world? If everybody's honest, we all do. But I found this so interesting. I thought this made it so clear that the anxiety of the world, the seed of riches, choke the word and it becomes unfruitful. Folks, they're hearing the word. They're not just hearing the word, but Felder, they're actually receiving it, right? Just like they did in the stony ground. And then it actually talks about has the word. That means he possesses the word. It's become a part of him, Maggie. Here's the problem. Then anxiety, cares, problems, and difficulties, they begin to spring up all around us. And what it's doing is it's making us become unfruitful. It's hard to be fruitful. It's hard to have a good testimony when you're so inundated with anxiety and so much stuff that you can't, you're just trying to survive yourself. Anyone ever been there? Man, if I can just get through this day all on my own. But when you're thinking that way, remember what I told you, when you got saved, it stopped being about you. It starts being about people who are lost. Amen? At some point, it has to stop being about you. Does that mean we don't have problems? Lord Jesus, read about the Apostle Paul. He said, man, I'm in trouble periodically. He said, on every side. Amen? And he was talking about being distracted, things that are happening to him. The funny thing about this verse is that it's often based on perception. Everyone say perception. In other words, I have the word, or I hear the word. In another version, it says, I hear the message. But because of worry, anyone worry in the house? Anxiety and things I can't control. Woo! We're preaching now. Does anybody else in the building ever struggle with anxiety over stuff you want to control, but you don't have control of? We all do. This might be the greatest obstacle to our Christian living. Because we're so used to, if I can just control this little space that I'm living in right now. Right? And this is how it is for me. About the time, Ray, that I think that I've really gotten control of, God comes in and messes everything up. Right? Throws me for a loop. Allow something to come into my life. Something that causes me to do what? To turn to Him. That's how it's supposed to work. What about this? Because of worry, anxiety, things I can't control. That word that faith, that peace, that joy is choked out and it becomes unfruitful. If you don't have no joy this morning, you know why? Because you're distracted by so much stuff that most of it you can't even control anyway. I was talking with someone over the past couple weeks and they told me about how fear often disables them. Anyone ever been in that position? Afraid to move forward, afraid to move back, afraid to move side to side because of the fear of the unknown. Fear often disables them, it distracts them. And as we talked, it struck me that fear was caused by a perception or how they felt they were being perceived by other people. Fear of failure, fear of the unknown, fear of something new. All of these things come from perceptions. We perceive inside ourselves that I'm not understood or accepted or liked or loved. We strive to fit in to a world that rejected our Lord, and he told us very simply that if they rejected him, they would also reject us. Yet we're so shocked when this happens to us. Church, I'll say it again, this is nothing more than a distraction. You're never going to fit into the world, and if you do, you need to check your relationship with God. This is not our home. When you go on vacation, how many likes to go on vacation? Man, going on vacation is, that's where it's at. It's fun, right? How many sleeps really good in that hotel bed? One, two. Yeah, I'm kind of like you and Nate. I just pretty much go to sleep, you know. Do I rest, though? That's another state. That's completely different. Resting is completely different than sleeping. Don't you agree? Amen? I may sleep, you know, those hours that I'm supposed to, but it doesn't mean that I'm resting. I can lay down up here on these chairs and go sleep. And it won't take me all day to do it. The problem is when we're not resting, then our body shows that. We love to go on vacation, but when we get into that hotel, as nice as you can get in a 5-star hotel, it can be, man, it can be everything and all of that and that you could hope for, but it's not home, is it? You may have the worst bed in the whole world, as we've had for some time. Thank the Lord we got a new one. Tom, it's taken me a while to get used to that new bed because I was so accustomed to sleeping on such a bad one. Amen. Home has got to be something that we feel comfortable in. And when we think about this in the context of this message here this morning, we have to consider that all of it is actually based on more perception than anything. A home should be where your loved ones are. I've always said my home is where my wife and kids are. It didn't matter what town I was in. It didn't matter what state I was in. It didn't matter what social status I had, what monetary positioning I was in. Home was where my wife and my children were because they're home to me. Amen. We strive to fit in, but we struggle to fit in. The other warning in this verse is it talks about the trap of riches. Does this mean that we should be poor? No. Lord don't want us to be paupers. But if we are paupers, he wants us to be the best paupers we can. I'll let that one sink in for a while. I used to work with a great guy. He was a good friend. Very, very talented. He's very gifted in sports and skill. And what I found out that after a while, we were working with a lot of guys in the surrounding area on these construction companies, that they worked unbelievable hours And they were always looking for overtime and always working on the weekends. And the, one of the things that they always talked about, they talked about how they were trying to provide a better life so down the road their children would be in a better environment and all this. But here was the problem. Their kids were growing up without their father or without their mother. And by the time the kids reach a certain age, you know when kids get a certain age that they no longer want to hang out with mom and dad because mom and dad ain't cool no more. Right? We try to learn all the lingo, right? But every once in a while, our speech betrays us, right? You remember when people used to say, "Man, that's boss." See, these younger ones are like, "What?" We all know where that came from, though, right? Bruce Springsteen, the boss. He started the whole movement. Okay, we said things that was cool, right? That's still pretty popular. Remember when everything was bad, right? I remember saying that around my dad, and he said, "What's bad?" He thought I was talking literally. I said, "No, Dad, bad is good." He goes, "What?" He said, "Boy, don't be stupid. Just say it's good." Right? We're trying to learn all the lingo, and we're trying to fit in. We're trying to find a home. Folks, here in this world, you're never going to be comfortable. Hopefully. Why? Because we're so distracted with so many other things that we don't have time to really find our place in the kingdom. We don't have time to find ourselves where we need to be. I say to those who face the challenge of, and I know Ray, she worked all night last night, got a couple hours of sleep, and she's here this morning. And I know that we have many that have to work those kinds of shifts, and you're not able to be in church all the time. But I tell you, and I challenge you, don't let that job infiltrate your relationship with the Lord. Because it's a distraction. Doesn't mean we quit our job because I'm not saying that. You need to know from God before you do something like that. But what I am saying is, whether you're working mid-shift, or you're working graveyards, or you're working days, or you're working Tuesday through Saturday, or you're working 7 days a week, don't let the job become your God. Because jobs come and go. Heaven and earth, it'll pass away. But Jesus Christ is going to remain forever and ever and ever. How desperately we need that relationship with Him. I want to say to those that find themselves having to miss services and stuff periodically because of work and obligations. It was said to Joshua in Joshua 1:9, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you all the places you go." The Lord is with you, whether you're on the job or whether you're traveling down the road, wherever you're at, the Lord is with you. And then finally this morning in verse 23, tells us about the good seed. The Bible says, "What was sown on the good ground, this is he who hears the word and understands it, who most assuredly bears fruit and brings forth some 100, some 60, and some 30-fold." This is something that is happening with inside of our hearts and our lives. As I considered what he said, it dawned on me, when we considered what I'm thinking about the parable of the sower, it dawned on me that perhaps we're looking at this parable of the sower, we should look at it from a different perspective. And that is that this should happen inside of our lives. This happens inside of our lives every day. Philippians 1:21, "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain." For me to live is Christ. That must be our focal point in everything that we do. I discovered that the problem wasn't in the sower. It wasn't that he was sowing instead of planting. And it wasn't found that the problem wasn't found in the seed itself. There was nothing wrong with the seed. The problem was the soil. I heard a preacher say that he felt like, if they were to rename this parable, it would be the parable of the soil. Because the soil was the problem, not the sower and not the seed. It's the soil. Some fell on good ground, some stony, some thorny, some just by the wayside. No effort was put into planting the seed. It was just simply scattered abroad. I said at the beginning of the message that I believe that Jesus was trying to reveal to us that these are four conditions of our heart. These are four conditions of our heart that we read right here in this parable. You can start out really good in the morning. You're praying and you study your word. And the seed, you gladly receive it. But as time goes along throughout that day, you can experience all four of these experiences. The enemy's right there to snatch it away. It's not taking root and it's dying off before it can produce a change. The cares of this life and the things that are going on, the anxiety of your job and your surroundings are choking the Word of God out. All of these can happen from the time you get up in the morning to the time you lay down your head at night. It's here that we discover the true meaning of this chapter. It's staying focused on His kingdom and His righteousness. For when we seek those things first, the Bible says that God will deal with everything else. Again, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Paul never alluded to the idea that there would be no struggles or distractions. In fact, he said in Romans 7 and 15, "For that which I do, I know not, for what I desire, that I do, I don't do. But what I hate, I do. If then I do that which I do not desire, I consent to the law that it is good. But now it is no more that I do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know in me, that is in my flesh, dwells no good thing. For to will is present with me, and how to perform that which is good, I don't find. I want to do it. I don't know how to do it." Anyone ever been there? "I want to accomplish what you're saying, Pastor. I just don't know how to do it. How do I get from here to there?" If you skip all the way down to the last verse, he said in the last two verses, "Oh, wretched man that I am." Paul felt this way. How do I accomplish this? I want to do it, but I don't know how. He says, "I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord." In other words, he said, that's the key. Jesus is the key. He said, "So then with my mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with my flesh, the law of sin." Paul said, "I'm filled with distractions. Things that cause me to lose focus on the most important thing, which is Jesus Christ, my Lord." To live in Christ means that no matter the distraction, we refuse to lose focus. As facts, or as I live in Christ, I in Him and Him in me. I can't afford to allow the facts to distract me from the truth. I can't allow the cares of this life to cause me to lose traction. You see, that's what the distraction really is. If you break this word up from distraction to distraction, it basically is telling us when we are distracted, we're actually losing traction. Think about it. Distraction. I'm losing traction. When your mind starts to wander on other stuff and you lose your focus, you are losing traction. Think about it. When a car loses that traction, it will lose its momentum. Oh, foolish Galatians! Who bewitched you? You did run well, he said. They lost traction. They got distracted on something else and lost traction. You did run well, he said. But who bewitched you? Who distracted you? As your pastor this morning, I'm challenging you here today. Don't get distracted. Because when you get distracted, you lose momentum. Amen? Think about being on an icy road. Once you break traction, once your tires start to spin, you've lost control. Amen? You've lost control. When I lived up in Alaska, one of the things that you could tell people that weren't used to being on the snow and ice, when they plow the road and the snow gets piled up on the side, people are, they think it, because I have a four-wheel drive, that means I have twice as much traction and I can do twice as many things as I should be doing. When the truth of it is, four-wheel drive just means four wheels sliding when it comes up to ice. Amen. And I don't know, for those of you that maybe have not spent a lot of time on the snow and ice, here's a good rule of thumb. Where that snow is on the side of the road, that's your traction. If you can just move your car over, I'm not talking about riding on the shoulder, but get at least one set of tires operating in that snow, it'll give you better traction than trying to do it on ice. Amen? Because remember, once you break traction, once your wheels start to spin, you've lost control. Have you ever done that? Have you ever started sliding? And you can just sit and do this with the wheel. You can do all kinds of things, but it's going to do what it's going to do. Folks, this is what happens to us in our day-to-day life. Once we break traction, we've lost control. So let me conclude. When we allow distractions to fill our lives, we will lose traction. When that happens, at best, everyone say at best, you stop moving forward. That's at best. You stop moving forward. If traction devices are not installed, there's only one direction you'll go. Backwards. Think about being parked on a hill. And once you break traction, you can pump the brakes all you want. You ever gone on YouTube and watched those people that are coming down the hill? Here a few years ago, it happened right downtown Seattle. They were down there on one of the hills. And what was the, it wasn't funny, but kind of funny. As you see the people, Tom, in the four-wheel drives. They said, I got a four-wheel drive, I can climb the hill. There's 40 other cars that had the reality that they couldn't climb the hill. But every once in a while, you'd see a four-wheel drive start to come up. And they would get up there, and then pretty soon, where the guy was filming, here comes a four-wheel drive sliding backwards. And they're just piling up cars. Just piling them up. Why? Because they broke traction. And if you don't get those, if you don't get traction devices put on, there's only one direction you're going to go, and that's backwards. Church, understand these parables that I've shared with you this morning. This is all about the condition of your heart. It's the condition of our hearts in here. Nate alluded to this last Wednesday night. Distractions will lead to our demise. It may start out well, but if you allow yourself to become sidetracked, it will pull your attention away from those things which lie before you. Why do we say to our kids all the time when they first start driving, don't play the radio too loud? You ever tell your kids that? Man, don't have the radio so loud that you can't hear what's going on. It's a distraction. Don't ride in the car and pile it up with all of your friends in there, because they'll distract you from the importance of driving. Now, most common thing of all, texting while driving. Am I guilty of it? Sure, I'm guilty of it periodically. Oh, my daughter's giving me all kinds of weird faces up here. But any time, think about it, any time you pull your attention away from the road and you look down, or you look in your mirrors, or you look behind you, any time you pull your attention away from what's in front of you, there's danger. There's a danger that you could get in a wreck. Amen? I'm preaching to you about distractions today. I believe that if we're not careful, the devil will keep us so inundated with distractions that the trumpet will sound and we won't know what happened. Two men will be walking up a hill. One will be taken and the other is left. Two men will be working in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. And the sad part of it is, how much sin does it take to keep us out of heaven? Any sin. Well, what are you talking about, preacher? I'm not doing anything wrong. But to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. We can allow ourselves to become so distracted by the world and the things going on in the world and the things going on in our lives that we forget to keep the Lord first in our lives. Can I back that up scripturally? Revelation chapter 2, unto the church at Ephesus write, these things I have. You know, all these things that you're doing, he said, they're great things, and I commend you for them. He said, but I have some somewhat against you. I have something against you, he said. Why? Because you left your first love. Left. I'll say left. Not lost. Some preachers misinterpret that, or they misquoted. They say lost their first love. But losing something, if I lose something, don't you search to find it? You'll search everywhere, trying to find what you lost. Like Terry looking all over the house for her glasses. They're on her head. It's the other night, I was trying to find Sarah's car keys. It's us getting ready to go to the game the other night, and we couldn't find her cell phone. Or we were trying to find extra sunglasses. And so we're looking everywhere, trying to find sunglasses. Lost is different than left. If I leave something, if I just set it down, walk away from it, I know where I set it. Amen? Jesus said to that church at Ephesus, I have this against you because you left your first love. That means they set it down. They felt like they could do this on their own. It was a conscious, deliberate act. They left their love. And he goes on to say, if you don't repent, I will come and remove my presence from you. What are you saying today, preacher? I'm saying don't get so distracted by the cares of this life and the anxiety of this life. Don't get so distracted that you lose sight of the most important thing in your life, Jesus Christ. Would you stand to your feet this morning? For some of you that have had to listen to this twice now, I don't apologize. I hope you picked something else out of it that maybe you missed last week. Because we could sit and listen to the CD over and over and over and over and pick something up new all the time. You know why? Because our minds are inundated with distractions, even though you hear me preaching. Amen. How many had a different thought other than what I was preaching today come into your mind? Be honest. Oh, you bunch of untruth tellers. If we're not careful, those thoughts come in. Even good thoughts. I've done this. I do this all the time. The preacher's preaching and he says something. Man, it triggers another scripture. It triggers a thought. I thought, oh, man, I could preach that. Man, I could. You know, and in my mind, I start putting together a message. Oh, that's terrible, Pastor. Is it? It can't be. Because even though I'm thinking about those good things, amen. Even though I'm thinking about a positive thing, it's pulling my attention away from what Jesus wanted me here today. You know, you're not here by accident. Every one of you are here because the Lord wanted you to hear this message. Amen. You know why? Because he loves you that much. Amen. I want you to bow your heads this morning.